He exploits things in order of his own purpose. He accepts, Smith accepts without question throughout life, that our cognitive behaviour, our understanding of the world, was fueled by the imagination and the passions. Smith never doubts those propositions. He never doubts Hume's conclusion from this, that what gives solidity to our ideas about the world are, in fact, beliefs that we acquire in the course of common life, from birth to death. And what, again, Smith never doubts is Hume's remarks about the role that habits, customs, education, we might say indoctrination actually, play in shaping the content of those beliefs. And I'd like to call your attention to what this account of the principles of human nature, which occupies the whole of the first of a very difficult, long first volume of the treatise, involves. What Hume is doing is, in fact, historizing the study of human nature. He is saying that there is no way in which we are genetically or spiritually hardwired with capacities which render the workings of the mind independent of the workings of the world of common life and experience. He has historized the study of human nature. And as he will say in a later work, he has made the study of the mind the study of the process of reasoning. The process of reasoning is a very interesting formulation. And I would actually suggest that there is work to be done, and interesting work to be done, on the relationship between the idea of process and progress. It's one of the, that seems to be one of the unexplored and big verbal demands of this area of research. And in fact, what he has done in describing the workings of the mind in terms of a process that takes place in the world of time and of history, is that he's also provided what in the 18th century people call a natural history of the mind, a history of minds in general, not the history of minds in particular. Now, this is the subject of the first volume of Hume's treatise. In the second volume, Hume has to cope with the problem which his first volume has raised. All our experience, Hume is saying, and in fact assuming, takes place in the world of common life, in the world of society, in the social world. It presupposes that in some sense we are social. We are born into a world of sociable animals. But what has made us sociable animals? We all know that, in fact, we prefer others, we prefer ourselves, our families, our friends, to other people. Everyone knows that, whether we're being selfish or whether we're being benevolent. So how do we explain? How do we explain where the ideas, which again we all have, that there is such a thing as justice, there is such a thing as morality. Where do these come from? They can't be hardwired. That is forbidden by Hume's rules, and in fact by the rules that Smith will adopt. And what he does, what Smith and Hume does, is to say, let us attend to the experience in common life that we all confront. Everyone's rich and poor, high and low. And that is the experience of scarcity. scarcity as it affects possessions. Every child knows, every parent knows, that the move to say this object is mine is as an experience that affects every single unit of child at some stage. And the invention of property, for Hume, the whole weight of his analysis of human beings as social animals hinges on this experience, as he puts it. This experience of coping with scarcity and seizing a commodity and saying it is mine. And the way Hume works on the consequences which flow from this, if we say it's mine and not yours, we are also saying that it is not fair, it's a right. I have a right to it. If I have a right to it, someone ought to defend that right if my brother attacks it and tries to take it away from me. And that someone is going to be someone with authority. Someone who can actually say that is going to be some sort of sovereign or proto-sovereign. And it is only that after it is only after we have begun to internalize the idea that that property, possession, peace can only be preserved by someone we regard as a legitimate sovereign, that society is possible, that peace is possible, and actually we look forward, the progress of civilization is possible. Now, what is interesting about this is that, which is something which I think tends to get in some cases omitted, and particularly in Smith's studies, the enormous importance of maintenance of regular government as a precondition, not simply to ordinary civil peace, but to the maintenance of society itself. In Hume, as everyone knows, the weight of his political thinking is on the crucial importance of maintaining the authority of government in a world in which everyone will have different ideas about whose property belongs to whom. We all believe in justice, but as long as it, what we read is we believe in justice, in fact, it's going to preserve my rights rather than someone else's. It's only stable government to do this. In the human world, and if I'm saying in the baseline of the science of man, the preservation of the authority of government as a means of preserving rights which are conventional, they're not natural, becomes absolutely paramount. And notice that the authority of any government is simply going to depend, as Hume himself says in later essays, on opinion, on the opinions of statistically stacked numbers of people belonging to different interest groups, that this particular form of government can maintain my property, my life, my interests, my rights. Now, I'm arguing that this is a package that Smith takes over intact. It matters, it's going to matter hugely to the wealth of nations, to the infrastructure of the political thinking in the wealth of nations. It is going to be all importance to his jurisprudence. But there is a question about what was to happen next. What we have done at the moment is to reach the end of the treatise of human nature. We've got to 1740. Hume had to decide what to do next. He was not a happy man. His book had only been read by professors. He didn't actually care about professors very much. And he hoped it was going to be a bestseller. Well, how stupid could he be? get. I mean, ever there was a book that was never going to be a bestseller. It came to be The Treatise of Human Nature, which is a very long and very difficult book. But anyway, that was Hume. But the question was, what's due next? Now, a purist might have said that what you've done is to develop a theory. The theory is imperfect. There is a lot more to be said, for example, about the mechanics of how we acquire beliefs, what the leaf acquiring process is. Hume sketches out all sorts of things. But he does not, I'm going to come back to this in a minute, but he does not explain that. And then, rather more dramatically, there is the question of his political theory. Now, leave aside the notion that a lot of people don't like the idea that our rights are conventional rather than natural. We will leave that one aside for the moment. What does matter in terms of Hume's theory is that his theory is based entirely on a theory of property. But we all know that property means different things in different times, in different places. In hunter-gatherer societies, in pastoral societies, in feudal societies, and in commercial societies. And therefore, ideas of just of rights, justice, morality, are all going to differ. And this is something which, in purely theoretical terms, needs to be explained. Hume makes no effort to do that whatsoever, and never showed any disposition to do so. He's aware of the problem that appears in various essays, but he's not interested in theorizing. Instead, what he does is he abandons natural history as he's done. He's given us a natural history of the mind, a natural history of how we acquire our ability to think as sociable creatures. But what he's done now, and what he is going to do, is to change direction and write civil history. Because what he's done by exposing, by a theory of politics, which in fact exposes the problem, reduces the problem of government to simply maintaining the rules of justice in a country which is necessarily going to be divided about its ideas of what rights are, what property rights are, and all the rest of it. And he takes as his example England, the country to which Scotland, after all, has been united, a country whose politics were greatly distrusted in Scotland, I may say, that's a different subject. And so what he does is he starts by writing a civil history of the England he knows. The England of the 1740s, 50s, and 60s. Hopelessly torn by political parties, ideologically directed, indoctrinated parties, some of them personal foreigners, all sorts of things. And it's in danger of falling apart according to Hume's analysis. And then what he will do is to take the story backwards into the history of England, and will write an extraordinary history of England, which is not, ladies and gentlemen, a history of progress in England. I have read all sorts of well-meaning accounts of people who are trying to turn Hume's history of England into a materialist history of England. It isn't. It's a history, it's a story of English history seen from the point of view of governance. Kings, rulers, trying to maintain their thrones and the rules of justice, and to in fact sometimes hopelessly get them wrong, sometimes try to improve them. And it's this move from natural history, which he takes as a philosopher, working in a Newtonian spirit, to civil history that is Hume's trajectory. And what it does is it clears the ground for Smith. And it's to Smith that I now want to turn. Because what Smith does, it seems to me, is to take the problems that are built into Hume's account of the mechanics of belief, and do some extraordinary work on them. In many ways, if, build on, transform, I'm not quite sure what verb I would use. And at the same time, he is going to develop Hume's theory of property with, again, extraordinary consequences. In the case of the theory of belief, what he does, and it's a very characteristically Smithian thing to do, in my view, he picks up Hume's comments that language has everything to do with the way in which we acquire the beliefs we acquire. Language, which we acquire at home, in schools, in civil society, and all the rest. Hume always admits that. There are lots and lots of references to the value of conversation, discourse, in shaping the beliefs of any society. And he also takes another point that Hume makes. Hume says that one of the characteristics of human society is our limited capacity for sympathy with other people, sympathetic interactions with other people. Smith will pick this up along with the idea that more needs to be said about language. Language and sympathy are going to be knitted together. And what he does is he starts the work on this at a very early age, he's in his late 20s, in lectures almost certainly in Edinburgh, but then continued in Glasgow after he becomes Professor of Moral Philosophy at Glasgow, or Professor in 1752. And what he does, it's really very, very interesting for people who want to see the end as well as the beginning of Smithian thinking. He asks the question, why language? What are the roots of language in human nature? His answer is need. Human beings, and he presents this, he calls this a conjecture, and it is a conjecture, but all human beings from the beginnings of human society, from Aboriginal societies onwards, have needed to cooperate. Cooperation means exchange. Exchange means language. In the case of an Aboriginal world, that is going to be sights, sounds, gestures, and so forth. In the modern world, it is going to be more or less what we know. But need, the notion of language of human beings as being absolutely fundamentally creatures of need, is something that Smith outlines at the very, very beginning of his philosophy. This would have led contemporaries to say, oh, he's an Adamillian, it's crying, it's a line of thinking. But it isn't quite that, because Smith being Smith, things are twisted. Because Smith is interested, as a student of rhetoric, in the process by which we learn language, by which we acquire our language skills, by the process of linguistic interaction. He's interested in all of that. And what is interesting about it is that, of course, part of it is because we wish to inform, to persuade other people. Doing deals like with the butchers and bakers, perhaps. But also, the thing that is interesting that he introduces at this stage, which I've not seen introduced before into this sort of discourse, is to say, actually, we get pleasure from doing it. There is pleasure in trading, whether it's goods, services, and sentiments, but also if we're trading ideas with other people, the way in which we modify our positions, we try our positions with other people. That is pleasurable. And the pleasure feeds into our ability to sympathize with other people, to achieve sympathetic, sociable relations with other people. Language becomes the crucial resource which enables us to become not only socialized in the sense of having our instincts repressed, but in having the personality being formed and the pleasure principle being introduced into a study of me. And I must say, just personally and subjectively here, I can't get out of my head that so much of Smith's philosophy develops in the classroom with young teenagers, not modern age students at all, but people 13, 14, 15. He's dealing with people who are modifying their personality and acquiring in the process an identity. They're beginning to be able to relate themselves as language users to others around them with whom they are interacting and engaged in the process of exchange. And this is a line of thinking which acts as the base, it seems to me, almost the preparation for his, what the moral philosophy course he would develop and then publish in the theory of moral sentiments. And one of my great criticisms, it's one of my very few great criticisms of the Glasgow edition, is that they omit to reprint Smith's essay on the origin of language as an appendix to the third and sixth editions of the Wealth of Nations, which is what Smith did. Smith never does anything without a purpose. He put that in because he knew that he wanted thoughtful readers to realize just the importance of the language theory on which this whole thing was being built. I think it was wrong of Glasgow to admit